build no slave ship. We ain't make those anchors. We ain't plot those grave sites. Up since daylight, burdened by the things we try to make right. It's gonna be a late night. So much turmoil makes my blood boil. Kundalini encore. Earth is unbroiled, dirt is unsore. With one core, tell a story that some spoil. Watch it unfold, stories untold. Copyright unsold. Books with one spine, ghosts with one soul. They want control, you want control. But we share one goal. We fight one foe. Satchel your front door, and it keeps knocking, but the people kept rocking, yeah. It keeps knocking, but the people kept rocking, yeah. Can't stop, flex, whatever they do. They can't stop, keeps knocking, keep rocking, yeah, yeah. They can't stop us, no, no, nah. They can't stop us, no, no. They can't stop us.
When it comes to answering questions about the ancient history of the American Southwest, or any history in general, the experts have no definite answers, only well-funded theories. These theories are well-funded because they must always fall in line with the pre-established doctrines of big academia. The Bering Strait migration theory, the monkey-to-man evolutionary model, and of course, any Eurocentric philosophy that denies the historical, intellectual, or civilizational antiquity of America. The apex of their history holds that the first Americans were Siberians, and the only Africans ever in America were brought as slaves. Wrapped in these theories of grandeur is a purposeful conflation of race, genetics, and history. Along with these illusions of truth, chronology is often used to create huge, unperceivable gaps in time for the purpose of separating events in the past by placing them in incomprehensible eons of yesteryear. They use radiocarbon dating as their tool of deception, a methodology that has been proven over and over again to be an erroneous science. For a discipline that claims to be accurate and true, it often misses the mark by over 1,000%. As if it isn't already hard enough to speculate on the age of an inanimate object like a rock, radiocarbon dating is well known for drastically counterfeiting the age of human remains. So if their advanced spectrometer can't accurately date the chronological age for human remains, what makes you think they have any chance of dating a rock? If their machine tells you that this man exhumed from a grave was 27,000 years old, but his headstone says he died in 1785, who you gonna believe? That's an inaccuracy of over 26,500 years for someone who died less than 300 years ago. Their technology is more wrong than anything close to being right. They could have said the nigga died yesterday or tomorrow and still would have been more precise than their machine. So be wary of some archaeologist or geologist saying that something is 50,000, 50 million, or 5 billion years old. They don't fucking know. They are slaves to the machine. But they've been given license by big academia to bullshit you. Nobody, and I mean nobody, is accurately dating any object or event from 50,000 years ago, much less 50 million years ago. I give them about 5,000 years max to somewhat accurately date something, and that's, give or take, about 5,000 years. And many of these events that geologists and archaeologists say happened 50 million years ago, in actuality, happened within the last 5,000 years. So when we hear some of these people say something like, the Grand Canyon was formed over 5 million years ago, they are totally and absolutely full of shit. The Grand Canyon is one of the most popular and spectacular places on Earth. And yet, it is filled with mystery and intrigue. The geological fascination alone makes this location a bucket list destination. But what do the experts say about its geological history? Some of these experts say the canyon is over 70 million years old. Here's a quote from the National Park Foundation. Quote, "It has been long believed that the Colorado River began carving the Grand Canyon about 6 million years ago. But a 2012 study contained a real shocker, suggesting that the process may have begun as far back as 70 million years." End quote. This time frame, from an Earth history standpoint, is a nanosecond. For example, if the Earth is 4.5 billion years old and it took 6 million years for the river to form the canyon, well, that's less than 0.1% of the history of the Earth, according to them, basically meaning the Grand Canyon formed overnight.
So we take these garnets back to the laboratory. We cut a very thin section. We put them under an electron microprobe. And the scientific result after this analysis is that we were 6 miles deep beneath the surface of the peaks, which were above us. And that's a long ways.
So, nearly 2 billion years ago, before the canyon evolved, ancient mountains 6 miles above sea level stood here, towering peaks as high as the modern Himalayas. Over the next 500 million years, these mountains were worn away by the relentless forces of erosion. Over millennia, the freezing and thawing of ice cracked open the rock of the mountain slopes. Wind and water carried the rock debris down towards the oceans, leaving behind a flat and featureless plain with no sign at all of a canyon.
According to the accepted geological narrative, the mountains in this area were over 6 miles high, making them once taller than even the Himalayas are today. But over time, they say, 50 million years, the mountains were eroded by wind and rain and eventually weathered down by over 20,000 feet. Geologist Carl Carlstrom asserts that this material can be substantiated by calcium deposits in the rock and dates these mountains once higher than Everest at 1.7 billion years old. Inflated chronology aside, this is a super dramatic change to a landscape from rocky mountains the size of Himalayas to the arid desert we see today. But this wasn't the only change to the American Southwest, and definitely not the most recent, for the canyon or the river. We will soon see that this harsh desert country changed more face than Michael Jackson. Shimon! But before we dig deeper, pun intended, into the geological history of the Colorado and the canyon, let's revisit some of the incredible yet overlooked archaeological anomalies in this area. One of the most odd archaeological findings in this region are the habitations of the cave and cliff dwellers. Not only were these enclosures constructed in some of the most impressive places to traverse or even climb, it has even been suggested that some of these races of people may not even have been human in a classical sense. Because how could they have lived in these high rocky sky caves if they had been human and fit through tremendously small doorways less than 3 feet tall, if they had been human? These living quarters are built high upon rocky cliffs, sometimes hundreds of feet above ground level, in places that could only be reached by expert rock climbers. Were the cliff dwellers a race of dwarves? It has been suggested within this area by legend that there once was a race of cannibal dwarves. It has often been speculated that the cliff dwellers were a race of cannibalistic dwarves who lived high on mountain and canyon cliffs to avoid being attacked. However, the official narrative states that the men averaged a height of 5 feet 4 inches and the women averaged a height of just around 5 feet. Although they won't be starting on anybody's basketball team, these people at an average of 5 feet tall wouldn't necessarily be considered dwarves. However, there has been evidence uncovered that there were people living in this area who were as short as 18 inches to 3 feet tall. Not just only small enough to be considered a dwarf, but tiny enough to even be considered a fairy. When these world-stopping discoveries are made, people are usually encouraged to call the Smithsonian, after which they are never heard from again. The accounts of magical and cannibalistic pygmy dwarves persist across the mythology of several tribes in the Southwest, including the Shoshone and the Paiute. The Grand Canyon is home to several pre-Columbian cliff dweller and Pueblo civilizations that all have again seemed to be missing from the archives of academic world history. How significant were these Southwest nations of people on a scale of size and population in comparison to other places in the world? As stated before, according to the accepted version of pre-Columbian history, the most dominant city-states in the Americas, for example, Cahokia or Mound City in Illinois, mysteriously vanished around the year 1350. Most historians often conflate and exaggerate the accounts of European smallpox, which we now know was actually Salmonella, as the reason for the mysterious disappearance of several civilizations, including the Aztecs. But these civilizations along the Mississippi and Colorado especially were determined by those same historians to have vanished around the year 1350, which means they already had disappeared by the time of the first Europeans to the continent. So that notion is completely false based on their own chronological determinations. Yet, that narrative still gets tossed around by academics as a reason that entire civilizations just up and disappear. This is another example of how these con artists use chronology to falsify historical perspective.
Sobrevivo sin saber si voy. Sobrevivo sin saber si voy. Sobrevivo sin saber si voy. Sobrevivo sin donde estoy.
One ancient ruin, Yellow Jacket Ruin, was home to more people than London and Philadelphia in 1776. In truth, there are at least several dozen ancient cities in the American Southwest, and many more yet to be uncovered, all within a 300-mile radius of the Grand Canyon. If we were to expand that radius, there would be hundreds, if not thousands, more. In Arizona alone, there are hundreds of sites, all of varying sizes, that span across the entire state. Canyon de Chelly, one of the largest parks in the state, has several ruined sites, including but not limited to White House Ruin, Antelope House Ruin, First Ruin, Yucca Cave Ruin, Ledge Ruin, Sliding House Ruin, Massacre Cave Ruin, and Mummy Ruin. Undoubtedly, this park has more sites, but most of the park is completely restricted from the public, and visitors must stay on trailheads and can only be accompanied by a park ranger or the approved Navajo Greenback. Speaking of, Navajo National Monument, a park the fraction the size of Canyon de Chelly, about 100 miles away, also has its own well-preserved cliff dwellings. At about a two-hour drive south from the Grand Canyon is Montezuma Castle National Park, one of the most impressive ruins discovered in the area. The castle is described as a prehistoric high-rise apartment complex. The structure is positioned almost 100 feet up a limestone cliff within a rock alcove, which helped protect the complex from rain, wind, and erosion, which is one reason behind its long-standing preservation. Also nearby is Wupatki National Monument, a little more than an hour from Flagstaff, Arizona. These ruins contain over 100 rooms and the northernmost ball court discovered on the continent. Well, shit, maybe the 5-foot Pueblos was playing. Maybe it was dwarf basketball. Maybe they had a league, the Dwarf League, right? How tall were the rims in the Dwarf League? I mean, because that's a real question. Yeah, hit me in the comments. Agua Fria National Monument, right outside of Phoenix, not only has petroglyphs, but also the remains of an ancient fort. And by no means are these the only sites within the state, but this shows proof that just within a 300-mile radius of the Grand Canyon in the state of Arizona, there is an entire history unaccounted for. And of course, this doesn't include Utah, Colorado, New Mexico, or even Nevada, where just as many sites are located. The Gila Cliff dwellings are just over 300 miles away in New Mexico. Prior to the year 1910, several mummies were discovered in and around these Gila dwellings and were given to the Smithsonian, never to be heard from again. This will become an ongoing theme as it relates to new discoveries. All information ends at the Smithsonian, which leads us to the 1909 article in the Arizona Gazette entitled Explorations in the Grand Canyon. In the article, an explorer named G.E. Kincaid, working for the Smithsonian, claimed to have found hieroglyphics, a Buddha statue, and Egyptian artifacts within a cave along the Colorado River. He also claimed to have seen several Egyptian mummies. Side note, mummification of the dead wasn't only a practice of ancient Egyptians, as superficial academia would have you believe, but also a practice of ancient and not so ancient Americans. So finding mummies isn't enough evidence within itself to seem unusual. The article goes on to say that Kincaid estimated that the cave where the ruins were found was so large that 50,000 people could have lived in it. However fantastic this account may be, nothing ever came of it, and the Smithsonian has since denied the story and that G.E. Kincaid was ever employed by them or ever even existed, leading many people to believe this story was a hoax. Well, if there isn't a lost Egyptian city in the Grand Canyon, why are its most prominent peaks named directly after Egyptian gods? For example, the Tower of Set, the Tower of Ra, Horus Temple, Cheops Pyramid. There are even peaks named after Hindu gods, like Vishnu Temple, Buddha Temple, Brahma Temple, and Shiva Temple. They even have Sheba's Temple and Solomon's Temple. Two of the most prominent formations named after Egyptian deities are Osiris Temple and the Isis Temple, both at elevations above 6,500 feet. And yet, to be fair, there are other peaks named after Greek gods. It just so happens that the most popular and impressive formations have Egyptian names.
They actually got Hindu names, nigga, and that is a clue.
But the most imperative question being asked is why hasn't anyone sent an archaeological team into this area to investigate these claims? And as you may or may not know, these areas mentioned where Egyptian discoveries were made are completely forbidden to the public. Some of these areas are so remote and unreachable by road that anyone traveling into these territories doesn't have many options in terms of method of transportation. Any endeavor into this area would be extremely expensive and time-consuming, requiring weeks of supplies and food. Even the use of a helicopter would require multiple trips, supply drops, and check-ins. So even if some rich asshole could afford to pull off such a thing, the government would kibosh that joint off rip. You would basically have to pull off a covert operation without detection and hope that if you were caught by the military, they don't send one of those Obama drones to take you out. But the Grand Canyon isn't the only place with these restrictions. Every single other monument in the Southwest has the very same restrictions. And this doesn't include the millions of acres restricted to the public that are not in national parks.
Discovering the age of each individual layer of sand.
Technology is stupendous. This nigga knows sand age.
Through the rocks.
Here at Lee's Ferry, we can use this last 500,000-year history, along with our absolute dates and all the information we get. And the rate of canyon cutting here is about 1,000 feet per million years.
That's 1 foot in every 1,000 years.
Stop playing, dog. Bro, on the Colorado River, there's a dam here. There's a dam here. Here's a dam. There's a dam. Everywhere's a dam.
That's 1 foot in every 1,000 years.
And you talking about 1 foot every 1,000 years, nigga? Stop playing.
That's 1 foot in every 1,000 years. A little more than 1 inch every century. It proves that the entire 5,300-foot deep Grand Canyon could have been cut in a little more than 5 million years.
Empty Hoover, my nigga. Empty Glen Canyon. Empty any of them reservoirs, my nigga, and see what happened if that bitch don't cut straight through the earth, bro. Stop playing with me, man. You supposed to be a geologist? This is your top nigga? This is the nigga. So he looking back at the old rocks to say what it would have did before the dams. I got you. Yeah, he on it, boy. This nigga.
In geological terms, the mere blink of an eye.
That's the only thing I believe.
The investigation is assembling evidence on how the Grand Canyon was created. Green clay deposits support the theory that an ancient lake was big enough to spill over and trigger the canyon's creation. Deep water fossils prove that the lake existed 6 million years ago.
That machine he got absolute dates. That shit magnificent, boy. Now that's some motherfucking science right there, my nigga.
Horses in North America, they got them horses in North America, they got them horses in North America, they got them horses in America, they got them horses.
Quote from PBS.org. Interesting article here. Quote from PBS.org. Horses in North America, a comeback story. Ancient horses roamed the North American continent for millions of years. And many, many, many years later, horses played an integral role in building the foundation of the United States. There was a period of time when horses vanished from the continent, and the reason remains unknown. I want you all to pay special attention to that word vanished. It'll be an ongoing theme in the history of the Americas, especially North America. The word vanish. You know, what happened to the horses? They vanished. Because their history wants us to believe that the Europeans brought horses, right? There were no horses in the Americas until the Europeans came. Similar to writing and history and all of these things they hold so dear to their records. The oldest known species of the genus Equus is Equus simplicidens. I guess that's how you say that shit. Also known as the Hagerman horse, Hagerman zebra, and American zebra, which appeared about 4 million years ago. Not even a horse, you know, we got zebras. Let's keep reading. These early species of Equus didn't stay confined to North America. They were so successful, they expanded their range outside the continent. They first migrated into South America and later spread into Asia, Europe, and Africa. What? Niggas, these horses swam across oceans. So people came to the Americas via the Bering Strait. Did the horses leave via the Bering Strait? How exactly did these horses get to other continents when there was no contact between any of these ancient civilizations? Or so we're told and supposed to believe. We have intercontinental swimming horses, y'all. Just jumped in the Atlantic, just, hey, nigga, we out. Maybe the Pacific, right? Right? Maybe they swam the Arctic, you know? Who knows? All we know is, hey, they were successful. Like, they had a business of some sort. These horses were an enterprise. So successful that they migrated into other parts of the world, across oceans even. Or maybe they reversed the whole Bering Strait thing, right? They just, yeah, we're gonna go up this way. Snow horses. I guess there's a lot of horses up in the Arctic. I guess that's the only way they could get across continent if they didn't swim an ocean. But the oldest horses are found in the American Southwest. Continuing. However, about 10,000 years ago, according to their records, you know, 10,000 years ago, they can chronologically ascertain 10,000 years. See, just more of that bullshit, all right? However, about 10,000 years ago, at the end of the Pleistocene, most of North America's large mammals, including equus species, went extinct. The cause of their extinction is widely debated among the scientific community, with a definitive conclusion not yet determined, but several theories exist. Man, what happened to the horses? They used to be here. Isn't history fun?
We're learning history.
We are less than certain about the root cause of the extinction of American horses 10,000 years ago than we are about the events that led to the demise of the dinosaurs 66 million years ago. End quote. Eric Bendick. Bendick. Writer and producer of Nature's American Horses said to Nature, "We are less certain about the root cause of the extinction of the American horse 10,000 years ago than we are about the events that led to the demise of the dinosaurs 66 million years ago." All right, guys. All right. Yeah, these are the official charlatans, guys. These are the smart ones. Some possible explanations include climate change, human arrival, an evolution of grassland vegetation, or an extraterrestrial impact. Nigga, it was aliens. Aliens came, killed the horses. This is on PBS, bro. PBS.org, my G. The end of the Pleistocene or the last ice age likely caused a series of major changes to the continent's habitat and vegetation patterns. Also during this time, populations of bison began to grow and spread, competing with horses for food, causing a resource shortage. Oh, the bison versus the horses, and the bison won, apparently, according to them, a theory of theirs. Quote, "For all of the theories, most of the debate centers around the arrival of humans to North America and whether human overkill was directly responsible for their extinction," Bendick said. Quote, "If humans were the major cause of extinction, then the return of equids might be considered a rewilding or reintroduction of a native species rather than an exotic feral or invasive species on the landscape." End quote. That's Bendick. Bendick has experience filming a wide variety of North American wildlife, from tremendous bison herds to speedy groups of pronghorn, a thundering elk. With his experience, he wonders how these other ungulates survived this extinction period while horses did not. Oh man, these questions are endless. endless, I tell you. All of these other ungulates survived, yet the horses, they couldn't do it. Horses, you know, they are not suited for survival, right? Quote, horses are incredibly fast, powerful, and intelligent. They are adaptable to incredibly harsh and extreme conditions of drought, cold, and heat. For all these reasons, it's unlikely that human hunting would have led to their outright extinction, especially when comparable game species survived. Climate change and a shift in vegetation seem more convincing. However, my hunch is that a definitive cause is out there, we just haven't found it yet, Bendick said. Scientists continue to study this phenomenon, and new research continues to reveal new discoveries in this field, according to Bendick. Horses or anything, while horses in North America have vanished, those that had migrated out of the continent survived and thrived. About 4,000 years after North American horses disappeared, humans in other parts of the globe began to realize the usefulness of horses. Horses began to shape human history. Used for everything from hunting and agriculture to war and transportation, and in turn, humans shaped horses by selectively breeding them to grow larger and faster. In the 1400s, Spanish conquistadors brought European horses to North America. Or were they North American horses back home? Were these the same horses that fucking migrated across the fucking Bering Strait? Or were these the swimmer horses? Were these the horses that swam across a fucking ocean? Were these the Atlantic swimming horses? Or were they the Arctic frozen swimming horses? Or were they the fucking Pacific canoe horses? The horses that made the canoes in the Pacific. Or maybe they were the Bering Strait horses. They were the freaking horses of the ice and migration. The migration of the horses across the continent. In the late 1400s, Spanish conquistadors brought European horses to North America, back to where they evolved long ago. At this time, North America was widely covered with open grassland, serving as a great habitat for these horses. These horses quickly shaped and adapted to their former range and spread across the nation. About 1550, the first known feral horses escaped Mexico City, and more followed over time. Native Americans began to capture and ride horses, spreading them further across the continent. Man, this is a great, great, and complete story. Over the five centuries since their return to North America, horses have become one of the most numerous and widespread mammals of all time. The Spanish horses were first to sweep across the nation and became known as Mustangs. As Mustangs ran wild out west, the Morgan horse rose in prominence on the other side of the continent. Other breeds like the Appaloosa, the American Quarter Horse, also became popular among other communities. The United States is now home to over 100 registered breeds, the greatest variety of equidae in the world. End quote. From PBS.org. I don't know who the fuck wrote this article, but they'll keep their name off this bullshit.
North America, yeah, they got them horses. North America, they got them horses. America, they got them horses.
In just the last million years, the canyon has been transformed by other overwhelmingly powerful natural forces. Geologists have established that over 1.7 billion years, the Grand Canyon emerged from ancient mountains and prehistoric seas to become one of North America's geological icons. This is a rare look at one of the most remote and secret parts of the Grand Canyon. A series of small cone-shaped mountains line the canyon's edge. And there are flows of black rock running down from each rim. They come from a remarkable era just 725,000 years ago, when the peace of the canyon was shattered by volcanoes.
In season 1, episode 10 of America is Egypt, we highlighted some of the oldest maps of North America and the mystery surrounding the island of California. We also detailed the body of water that separated the island of California from the mainland continent, labeled on maps as Mer Vermilion or Mer Rouge, also known as the Red Sea. In the video, we learned that over 1,500 dams are currently in operation throughout the state, and without these dams and reservoirs, the landscape of the state would be totally different. Well, the same could be said about the Four Corners region, but dams and reservoirs aside, this place was a completely different landscape in the not-so-long-ago past.
And that shows that Lake Bitahochi once spread over 20,000 square miles and contained more than 3,000 cubic miles of water. That makes it bigger than Lake Michigan.
So not only were the mountains in this area taller than the Himalayas, it was a well-watered, lush, tropical paradise with access to the sea and large freshwater lakes, one the size of Lake Michigan. These themes literally run hand in hand with the past geological history of California. Lake Tulare was once a large freshwater sea, but has since been drained by big agriculture used as corporate farmland for the J.G. Boswell Company. When Boswell, a slave-owning farmer from Georgia, purchased the land in California, he strong-armed water rights and control of the area. He systematically drained the entire lake as part of a twofold plan of displacing Indians from the land and clearing the lake and using its fertile bed for a massive farm that today is over 140,000 acres, making it one of the largest in the country. This is a perfect example of how over a short period of time, even human intervention can change the course of natural history. Over in the Grand Canyon region and the surrounding areas, several massive bodies of water have disappeared, and the evidence still remains. Lake Alamosa, an ancient lake in Colorado, over a mile above sea level at over 7,000 feet, was seven times the size of Lake Tahoe. Lake Estancia, New Mexico, Lake Otero, New Mexico, in White Sands National Park, is an archaeological gold mine where the discoveries made have utterly demolished several classical, academically worshipped theories of big charlatanry, including their top two theoretical gods, evolution and Beringia. Among the finds in the park were skeletal remains of Colombian mammoths, giant sloths larger than grizzly bears, dire wolves, saber-toothed tigers, American lions, camels, and humans. These humans used weapons. The discoveries essentially rebuke any long-held theories the Pharisees claimed about the peopling of the Americas through the Bering Land Bridge, because that theory was completely tied to their asinine Ice Age theories that never held any water, which is ironic because ice is water. These humans in the Tularosa Basin were living amongst lions, tigers, and bears, sized sloths, oh my! Not to mention mammoths and camels. It's almost like these people were living in Africa before Or maybe they were living in Egypt before Egypt. These people could have never existed because, according to their theories, people still hadn't been fucked into yet, you know, by the monkeys. The homos have yet to be completely erect. So let's keep this in mind as we wade deeper into the waters of fuckery. Learn to swim in the idea that these ancient lakes and seas in the American Southwest are parallel with human occupation and civilization for as long as humans have ever been recorded.
That door in the Sphinx, does the library of that knowledge lie?
I think there is extraordinarily powerful evidence to suggest that this is so. If you were amongst the survivors of a high civilization and you had been, your civilization had been destroyed in an enormous cataclysm, and you wanted somehow to keep the memory of your civilization preserved and to pass down the knowledge to the future, and you might particularly want to do that if you believe passionately in the reincarnation of the soul, by the way.
When the Spanish first arrived to the Southwest, a few things were very apparent. For one, they were on a religious mission to Christianize Indians at the threat of slavery or murder. Another thing that seems to be consistent is that they thought California was an island, as did every other cartographer in the known world. The classical charlatan historian just simply chalks this up to a mistake. They mistook the peninsula of Baja California. And yet, that simple answer is not nearly enough to satisfy the curiosity of someone with half a brain to think for themselves. Well, if it was a mistake, why are there hundreds to thousands of examples of the exact same mistake across hundreds of years of cartography? If the Spanish long infiltrated Santa Fe by 1608, why were these maps still being made in 1656 and 1703? Why are the meridian lines on these maps still applicable to modern geography if these were mistakes? Look at this older map of the Western United States and the Isle of Cali. The Pacific is called the Sea of the South, and the Atlantic is called the Sea of the North. But we've always been taught to associate the Pacific with West and the Atlantic with East. At what point in history did cardinal directions magically change position? How could the South Sea be in the Northern Hemisphere? Obviously, we're conspiracy theorists. There is no evidence of map flipping here, just a secret polar shift that seemed to happen. Nobody recorded it. But of course, the most important question of them all is, why is the body of water separating California from the mainland called the Red Sea? Mar Vermejo, Mar Vermilion, and Mer Rouge all mean Red Sea. And a side question. On this map from the year 1700, why is there a pyramid right in the middle of America? This brings us to biblical history. So what about the biblical history of ancient Egypt? And are there any parallels between scripture, legend, and geography? As mentioned several times before, the prophecy of Isaiah in chapter 11 describes the Mississippi River as the Great River Euphrates, and the Nile was a generic term used by the Greek describing a tributary creek or stream. The Nile is not a proper noun of a river in Scripture. Additionally, the geographic characteristics of the Nile in Africa do not match at all the river mentioned in Isaiah. First of all, the Nile in Africa does not have the seven streams mentioned in the chapter. Those streams are the Red, Arkansas, Missouri, Illinois, Ohio, and Tennessee rivers, as well as the Mississippi main channel. The Nile only has two natural tributaries, the White and Blue Nile. Also, the mouth of the Nile is not the Egyptian Sea as described in the text. The mouth of the Nile is the Mediterranean, which the Book of Numbers calls the Great Sea, and the Great Sea is supposed to be the largest body of water on earth. So it naturally could not be the Mediterranean Sea. Historical scholars are mostly in agreement that Petra in present-day Jordan was the location of ancient Edom. They say this because the cave dwellings nearby are said to be former Horite habitations mentioned in the book of Genesis chapter 36 that were deboed by the clan of Esau. The Horites were said to be cave dwellers who first occupied Mount Seir before their lineage was breeded out and into the Edomites, when Esau took Horite, Hivite, and Hittite wives. Edomea is another term associated with the land of Edom, or Mount Seir, whose inhabitants were called Horites from the lineage of Seir the Horite, Horite meaning troglodyte or cave dweller. However, Edomea, a Greek name implying Edom, isn't mentioned in the first books of the Torah by that name. Its first references to the name Edomea are in the prophecies of Isaiah and Ezekiel. Isaiah 34 describes a great slaughter in Edomea, in which the mountains will be melted with blood. If we were to take this prophecy literally, one could imagine seeing mountains in a blood reddish hue. And Petra is a city that looks like it could fit the description. Only one problem. Petra is not nearly old enough to be considered the ancient location of Mount Seir or Edom, given its documented construction in the early Roman era. The ruins of Petra have clearly defined Hellenistic architecture, which essentially dates itself. And the experts have no argument in this agreement. According to several biblical concordances, Edom literally means red or red earth. Although Petra looks somewhat red in some pictures, it does not fit the description nearly as well as the Red Canyons of the American Southwest. As a matter of fact, the word Colorado is a synonym for the word Edom, literally meaning colored red. But this truth gets even deeper, because now we can associate this area with a specific prophecy from the book of Isaiah. The mountains shall be melted with their blood. Iron is a significant component of blood, required to create hemoglobin. As maintained by the U.S. Geological Survey concerning the canyons of the Southwest, the cause of the red color predominant across these cliffs and canyons is iron. So when Isaiah 34 says the mountains shall be melted with their blood, we can see this prophecy written in rock. Geologists say there used to be mountains, but these mountains have been melted into red canyons. How long did this process take? Did it happen rapidly, or did it take 250 million years? And what does any of this have to do with America being Egypt? The Colorado and Mississippi are two of the most significant rivers on the North American continent, each resembling other rivers mentioned in scripture, both playing the role of national borders, acting as lines of demarcation for ancient kingdoms. On the Mississippi River end, no doubt a kingdom of corn, as this area produces more corn than anywhere in the world unto this day. So when Genesis 42 says there is corn in Egypt, where on earth could Egypt have been? Considering there was supposedly zero contact between America and Africa, this fact can't just be explained away by these charlatan historians who say the word corn actually means any type of mixed produce. Then they would have to explain, why is it described precisely as the corn we know today? And if corn was a name for mixed produce, as you suggest, why is other produce mentioned by name? Numbers 11:5. We remember the fish, which we did eat in Egypt, freely, the cucumbers, the melons, and the leeks, and the onions, and the garlic. Why didn't they just say corn? For the same reason they didn't just say gourd, or squash, or cucumber. Other foods mentioned in the book of Numbers and the second book of Kings that are also indigenous American foods. So why are they mentioned in the Bible in association with Egypt, if that food could have never been in Egypt? So we can see the charlatans are back with the bullshit. Corn being a generic term, right? Just like I said, Nile being a generic term for river, we're going to be looking at this from the opposite end of the spectrum. Corn, Dagon, a word used for cereals generally, much as our English word corn. The American Standard Revised Version almost invariably substitutes grain for corn. The latter may be taken to include barley, wheat, fitches, lentils, beans, millet, rye, pulse. Easton's Bible Dictionary, corn. The word so rendered, Dagon, Genesis 27, Numbers 18, Deuteronomy 28, is a general term representing all the commodities we usually describe by the word corn, grain, seed, peas, beans. With this corresponds the use of the word in John 12, 24. So you see what they did there? They jumped from Genesis to John to drown you in their fuckery. Hey, look at John. John has nothing to do with Genesis, guys. It's not the same book. Genesis 41, Proverbs 11, wheat. The word, thus translated, means purified corn from chaff. With this corresponds the use of the word in the New Testament in Matthew, Luke, and Acts. In Psalms, it means growing corn. Once again, if they're all supposed to be different things under the umbrella of corn, why have they been given different titles for recipes? Ezekiel 4:9, the recipe for bread. Take thou unto thee wheat and barley and beans and lentil and millet and fitches, and put them in one vessel, and make bread thereof, according to the number of days that thou shalt lie upon thy side. 390 days thou shalt eat thereof. The recipe for bread includes all the ingredients they say is corn. They're telling you, oh, this is all corn. This is technically cornbread. The only thing that could be considered corn, is because corn isn't mentioned in this verse, is millet, which is milled corn. So if corn was anywhere in there, it would be millet, in addition to these other ingredients that these so-called Bible charlatans all say is corn. Hey, take thou unto thee corn and corn and corn and corn and cornmeal and corn, and put it in one vessel, and make thee bread thereof, according to the number of days that thou shalt lie on thy side. Wade in the water, children. Wade through the waters of fuckery. The Egypt of the Bible is completely different from the Egypt sold to us in the history books by academics. The location the world believes ancient Egypt to be was discovered 200 years ago. And the Egypt from the Bible, people don't even believe exists. But let's be honest, if there are no pyramids or aliens mentioned in the Bible, that's not any fun, right? Well, if it's aliens you want, the Southwest has plenty of them, or so it has been reported by the public, who reports sightings all over the Southwest desert on a regular basis. And if it's pyramids you want, forget about it. America has more pyramids still standing than Egypt ever did. And this is not to mention the pyramids destroyed by Europeans, or the pyramids lost to apocalyptic catastrophes that changed the face of the earth. This includes the prophecies of Ezekiel concerning the destruction of Egypt. Chapter 29 states that Egypt will be utterly laid to waste and no man shall pass through for 40 years, and the Egyptians will be scattered among the nations. Is this why all of the civilizations in the Southwest were completely abandoned? Where about do you think these Egyptians were scattered? As indigenous legend states, the people who built the Aztec Empire migrated from a land to the north, theorized to be around the Four Corners region. So when it comes down to the Grand Canyon being Egypt, that most certainly could be true. But our idea of Egypt has to change. Academic and biblical Egypt, or Mitzrayim, are not the same. For my money, I think the canyon is Edom. And Egypt borders that territory and extends all the way to the Mississippi River and all the way down into Mexico. The Roman era following Christ should have solidified any European knowledge related to ancient Egypt, considering it was a Roman province during the time of Julius Caesar, Mark Antony, and Cleopatra. The Ptolemaic Empire had ruled Egypt since the days of Alexander the Great. But once again, no one knew anything about ancient Egypt until the French discovered the pyramids in 1800? Shouldn't the Romans have known? Shit, shouldn't the French and Spanish have known since they are Roman? They ruled Egypt for 600 years, according to the history books. Why hadn't they known anything about Egyptian culture or history for over 2,000 years? Make that make sense. Why are burials of the Ptolemaic dynasty in Marion County, Illinois? Why are there sandstone tablets depicting Cleopatra and Mark Antony found in the very same place? As the legend states, Alexander the Great died in Babylon at the palace of Nebuchadnezzar. From this point, the story gets a little cloudy. Many say that Ptolemy Philadelphus stole the body and took him to Egypt. But nonetheless, the body has never been seen again. However, there is substantial evidence that his body lies smack dab in the heartland of Middle North America. So far throughout this series, we have highlighted multiple city-state civilizations in just North America, all larger and more historically significant, with larger geographic footprints than any city in ancient Egypt or Europe. This essentially means that entire histories are being systematically suppressed for the purposes of downplaying their importance. This is by deceptive design. Manipulating the truth about world history is a control mechanism of the heathen who seeks to prop himself by stealing the works of others and calling them his own. But rest assured, his days are numbered.